So when we read the science of sleep, we and every research everywhere in the world, the most important thing that came out was that actually it is not a touch and feel product at all. The reason being, you as a person will know whether you like it or not only after sleeping on that mattress for 14-15 days at a stretch. So you telling yourself a story that I slept on it for 5 minutes in a store, this felt better than that, and hence I'm buying this, is actually a story you're telling yourself. So what we did was concentrate all our marketing on educating consumers that that's the wrong way to buy. And how do we still overcome the burden? We gave a 30-day trial. We said, you buy, retain it in the privacy of your home. And in 30 days, if you don't like it, if it doesn't suit you, we will take it back and refund the money. And this 30 days, we extended to 100 days later on, industry leading. And it's still to this day, it is a 100-day trial period for our mattress segment.
Hey, Chaitanya, thanks a lot for agreeing to do this. Really looking forward to the conversation.
Same here, Abhiram.
Chaitanya, if you could start with your story and, you know, where you grew up, early days, studying, and your early brushes with entrepreneurship. If you could start there and then, you know, deep dive into Wakefit's story, but would love to understand how all of this came about.
Yeah, my father retired as a state government official. He retired about 9 years ago. But prior to that, it essentially meant for us as a family that every 1 year to 3 years, we would have to uproot ourselves and move somewhere else within the state of Karnataka. So I did my 16 years of formal education in about 10 different institutions and in about 6 or 7 different cities. And that meant that I was constantly moving around as a child, making new friends, seeing new places, going through the whole process of finding a new school, getting registered, a new language, because Karnataka itself has multiple ways in which Kannada is spoken. So very different. And I personally think it was a great thing because it gave me a lot of exposure to different parts of the state. And probably in hindsight, it taught me a lot of adaptability. And because you're not just in your comfort zone, in the same set of friends for the 16 years of your education and so forth. But unfortunately, the thing that I do miss is that back then there was no WhatsApp, there was no Facebook. So I've lost touch with a lot of those friends, but that taught me a certain few lessons. In terms of brushes with entrepreneurship, back then I didn't know it was entrepreneurship, but after my 10th standard, when I was 15 years old, I went and joined coaching class for spoken English, where as a teacher, so I would, because I was from a normal English medium school, and this coaching class had been had built a history of about 5-6 years, and they were paying people like me 10 rupees an hour to handle classes, and the students would be a completely motley mix of people. There would be a housewife, there would be a salesperson, there would be a student who has come from a rural background and is now trying to understand and learn in English medium. So very, very different set of people. And they used to pay us 10 rupees per hour for handling a class. And however number of classes or hours you handle, you get that money. So I didn't know that I'm being entrepreneurial, but I wanted to earn money. I wanted to run a profession. So I joined there, did that. And the next year and the year after that, in summer vacations, I started my own spoken English class in Mysore, where I took up my aunt's garage, put up an advertisement in the local newspaper, and then started the same process all over again. So that gave me a very good exposure. I didn't know what I was doing. I had no clue. But I knew that I had certain skill sets that I could sell and certain people who would value and pay for that. And that's how the classes sort of happened. I did it over 2 or 3 summers, and that gave me a lot of exposure.
Understand. And so, you know, you went to college. Like everyone, you would have decided, hey, you know, let me do a job. When were the first, you know, few thoughts that you wanted to start something? When were they incepted, or when did they come up, and what was the inspiration? love to understand that.
There's that running joke, right? In India, people become an engineer or a doctor and then figure out what to do with their life.
Right.
They don't pick up a degree of education because they want to do something with their life. I was exactly the same. I did my engineering in computer science from National Institute of Engineering, Mysore. Then worked as a software engineer in companies such as IBM and NTT Data, Japan. And post that, I did my MBA from ISB Hyderabad. In 2005, I graduated. Then the next 6 years, I was in the US and Canada, predominantly working with Fortune 100 companies as a management consultant. So what that enabled me to do was to truly understand how corporations function. What does a customer service department do? What does product engineering team do? What does product management team do? What does a sales force and a marketing team does? So that gave me amazing insight into how good and great companies are built. It was a lot of traveling and across different cities, different countries. It was a lot of learning. I really cherish those. But if you've spoken to anybody who's been in the management consulting industry, over a period of time, the travel gets to you. I finally wanted to quit, but not to start another job. Those were the days when, imagine, Flipkart was just doing well. It was 2010-11 period. Flipkart was just doing well. There were a lot of news articles about how Flipkart is creating a new category, trying to raise funding. Those initial days of Tiger Global funding and all was happening back then, the first 10 million check. Then early VCs such as Accel back then was one of the few VCs that was active back then. Then Matrix, I think Avdish Bajaj was planning to or something around that time. So we were hearing news about that. So very exciting times. So I had no clue it was going to become this big as a sector, as an industry. But I knew that I enjoyed the current job that I had, which was management consulting. I was the head of a practice. I enjoyed the work. I enjoyed the travel. Customers liked the work that I did. So what do I have to do in order to move from here? So it was very clear that because I enjoyed everything that I was doing, it wasn't me quitting because I want to join another company for pay scale or a brand name or anything. So, and at management consulting, I had worked as hard as anyone could. So the two things that came was, hey, this is a really exciting thing. And I do enjoy doing things. And I have no hesitation in doing any part of the building the company. Whether it is administrative work, whether it's marketing, whether it's sales, let me just go ahead and learn. And so that's how I sort of saved some money for about, and I didn't know how long it would take, nothing. So I had saved some money for about 6-7 months of expenses, and then I quit. And that's how it started. My first couple of ventures were in the consumer internet space.
Understand. Got it. And you spent, you know, I think after you started running these companies, you briefly went back to spend some time in the ecosystem, I think with a media company as well as an incubator accelerator focused on the startup ecosystem.
Yes, I did my startups for about 4 years. Pretty much lost all of my money. Bootstrapped, because those were both bootstrap ventures. The team had grown to a 10-member team. I was managing to pay their salary, running the operations, pivoted multiple times, built online communities on a shoestring budget. Online communities of as large as 1 million visitors a month on almost zero marketing budget. So did all of that, but I was burnt out by then. I knew that this is not why I quit my job. This is not exciting enough for me to say that I'll spend the rest of my life doing this. Second thing was, I was completely out of money. Third thing was, I was just doing things to, one, keep the team going, pay their salaries. Second, I was doing things because I felt like if I stopped, it was giving up. So back then, I felt I didn't want to give up. So I just fought on, and at some point in 2015, I gave up and shuttered the startups and managed to find jobs for the team. And then I took up those two jobs that you mentioned. One was heading product for Your Story. and second one was heading investor relations for Let's Venture, which is India's largest fundraising platform for startups. So again, it was not because I specifically chose them. I obviously knew the two founders, Shraddha Sharma and Shanti Mohan. I was able to know, I earned their trust and got the job. But it was, I joined there, one, because I continued to want to be in the startup ecosystem. And second, nowhere else was my 3.5-4 year expertise in entrepreneurship was valued. People wanted me to come back at a lower salary, at a lower title when I went back to the industry. So I was like, okay, if I've spent these three and a half years, 4 years, and these founders are trusting me enough to give me certain responsibilities, and I can stay in the startup ecosystem, why not take that up? So that was the genesis, and I spent and I learned a great deal from those companies and those exposures.
Amazing. I mean, super story, and I think lot of learnings. The not giving up and continuing a company, I think it's a feeling a lot of founders have when things are not going as well as expected. It's very interesting that those experiences obviously contributed to building Bigfoot. So you spent time, you know, in these organizations. I think you had a shorter stint after that somewhere else, and then you started Wakefit. So what was the process of starting Wakefit? Why did you decide to do this? What was the origin story as such?
So the other company that you sort of didn't take a name of, that is where I ended up bumping up with my current co-founder, Ankit. So that was a company called HelpChat, which was later rebranded to Tapzo. And back in 2017 or something, it was acquired by Amazon Pay. So it's now a part of Amazon. But back then, we were building a large chat platform which could serve customers. Remember 2015-16 was the period where people were talking about how chat is going to eat consumer.
Right.
Which means every single sector was trying to get into NLP, chat automation, bots, and trying to service every single thing that a customer would want, whether you want a movie ticket, whether you want to shop, whether you want to book a cab. Can we aggregate and build everything in one place? That was the dream. That was a startup. It was funded by Sequoia Capital. And there I was heading operations and Ankit was in my team. So he used to report to me. And what we realized after we started to get to know each other was that although there's an 8-year age gap and he had just about 4 years experience by then, the journeys were very similar. Middle class, parent in a government organization, good education that parents supported and enabled. And then he had tried one startup, I had tried two startups. And he had done something in foam because his whole knowledge was in foaming. He's a chemical engineer from IIT Roorkee. So he had that expertise and he had shut that and he was now in this funded startup. What we realized as we became friends was that we both still had that itch to do, but we were both exhausted from having tried and having no resources left. But 6-7 months later, Ankit was getting married and he went to the market to set up his home, buy furniture, buy mattress, all of that. And he came back to me fully surprised, saying that, hey, CR, I know the cost of raw materials. I know the cost of labor. Something is not adding up. The price of the mattress is extremely, it's very expensive. And it's just not adding up. So I knew a little bit of accounting and MBA, right? Knew a little bit of things. So I said, okay, maybe your hypothesis is right. So we went and dug around in getting annual reports. So when we got annual reports, we figured out that these large mattress companies weren't making too much profit. They were normal 9-10% EBITDA, 4-5% PAT, like any mature industry would be. So one side, you see that it's extremely high priced. And on the other side, you see that the companies are not making too much money. So where is the money going? And when we did a little bit of digging, we figured out very quickly that all of the money was going in the value chain. So in a large city, there would be 2 levels of middlemen. In a smaller town, there would be 3 to 4 levels of middlemen. And we as customers were overpaying just because everybody in the value chain was adding their own margins. As simple as that. Hmm. So we said, okay, there seems to be an opportunity, but we obviously don't have the resources to open multiple stores and do all of that. So let's just take a contract manufacturer somewhere in Noida. Let's just put up a listing on Amazon and see what happens. So that was the genesis. And I had saved about 3 lakhs. Ankit had saved about 3 lakhs. So we said, okay, that should be the seed and let's just put and start. That's how we started.
That's amazing. And the way you arrived at the solution from the problem, that's wonderful. And you know, it will bring us to a topic which is disrupting an existing category. How you clearly identified a potentially matured industry that needed to be reimagined. But before we get into that, you chose to remain bootstrapped for the first 3 years. You know, you guys had excellent pedigree, had experience in startups, you had seen fundraising. You could have very well gone and raised money. I mean, I don't know if you tried, but was that a conscious decision to remain bootstrapped for a couple of years?
Yeah, you're right. A lot of our decisions at Wakefit were based on our learnings as entrepreneurs in our earlier stints. So when I was running those consumer internet startups, I had tried multiple times to raise funding, finally raised an angel round. Ankit had done the same thing. He had raised an angel round and some of it he had returned when he shut down his startup. And then later, when I worked with Your Story, when I worked with Let's Venture, and I saw how fundraisers happened, how companies were spending money, how companies were raising and how they were deploying it, it was amazingly surprising that founders were willing to bet the destiny of their company on an external event such as funding. So what it meant was founders would take on the fundraise, deploy that capital to get to the next fundraise milestone. And then when they would arrive there, they would raise again to deploy it further to get to the next milestone. So for us, and coincidentally, I had a colleague in one of those companies who was in a company that was competing in the hospitality sector against one of the large companies. They had raised about 160 crore and they had blown through 100 crore out of that in about 8 months. It was amazing. You have to really go back to 2015. That was real peak deal making time, just like we're seeing now in 2021. So the cycle keeps coming back every few years. That's normal for any ecosystem. But back then, it was really peak deal making time, and valuations were through the roof. Estimations of Indian market growth would be through the roof. So people were raising a lot of money, but using it like this. So when time came for us to raise funding in Wakefit, we were extremely cautious. It was a profitable business. The only money that we had put in was these 3 lakhs. Whatever profit was coming, we were pouring back into the business. We were taking very small salaries. I continued in my job for 9-10 months before I joined full-time with Ankit. So while we were doing all of that, we felt, do we really need to go and raise funding when we are in this situation, until we don't know what the product is, how it is going to scale, what is the market size? So we said, let's continue running and see what happens. And every time we would entertain an incoming request, and 99% of the time, these would be technology VCs. They did not understand consumer brands. They did not understand D2C brands. The whole gestation period, the time to build a brand, the kind of scale it will achieve, the kind of returns it will give the investor are all very, very different for consumer tech and consumer brands. So in India, 2015-16, and then till we raised in 18, it predominantly was filled with VCs who had deep expertise in tech, consumer tech. So we didn't want to raise for a few years. Then when we did start taking meetings, this is what happened. So that's how it kept getting pushed, where the first 3 years, we were completely bootstrapped. And that's when we raised from Series A from Sequoia Capital.
A lot to dive into here. Our topic for this week is disrupting an existing industry. And you've already touched on it and spoken about the opportunity that you identified. But what was the real pain point here that you were solving and when you started Wakefit? And what were some of the issues with the way that India slept?
Honestly, this whole sleep solutions positioning, all of that came much later as we understood our consumers. Back then, we were two people just trying to make a living, just trying to understand whether mattresses could actually be bought online. 2015 was the time when nobody was selling online on mattresses. When we wanted to list on Amazon, Amazon did not even have a category called mattresses in India. So they put us under furniture. So that's where our listing got live. And for those initial 5 or 6 months before we even incorporated the private limited, we ended up selling one mattress a day, one mattress every 2 days. We didn't know which one people are buying. Why are they buying online? Why are they paying 20,000 rupees online to an unknown company run by two unknown people and then still taking that risk? Who are these early adopters? Yeah. So we had no clue, right? So we started talking to customers. And the reason we started talking to was because the volume was so low. So one order a day, right? So yeah, we would just pick up the phone and speak to them and say that, how did you discover us? What made you buy? Is this the size that you ordered? Are you sure this is the variant that you want? And they would ask us questions. Where are you from? Which college? Why are you running this? And so on and so forth. Our very first customer was an NRI. He had just seen that mattress selling online had started in the US, and he had returned to India recently. And he said, oh, let me try. And that's how he had risked his money and bet on us. So when we started talking to these people, that's what gave us insight, that people figure that it is very, very expensive outside. Secondly, they feel that it is very inconvenient to go to a store and then make a purchase because they don't know what they're buying and why they're buying. And even to test the product, they were feeling, they didn't know that it is wrong to just lie down for 5 minutes on a mattress because science completely disproves that myth. I'll come to that. But as a lady, if you wanted to go and check it and test it in front of a salesman, it was always an awkward experience. You go lie down on a mattress in front of a stranger. So it's not at all a good experience. So it was very expensive. There was no way to try and buy. There was no customization. And it was very inconvenient to do this whole rigmarole and then get a product home. These were the pain points we discovered by talking to customers, not by hypothesizing.
And that's, I mean, can you, yeah, so you spoke about a few very specific pain points. Would love to know a bit more about like how you went from discovering those pain points to then making them part of your solution, and how do you
Sure. I think price was definitely one important factor, and we were able to achieve a good quality product, industry matching product, at a price point that was nearly 30 to 50% cheaper than an apples to apples product of a large company, was because we cut out the middlemen. So we didn't have 3-4 levels of distributors, dealers, final retailers. We would manufacture in our factory and then it would go to the consumer's home, simple. And that essentially meant we had to invest in manufacturing. Again, going back to 2015, this was peak Uber period. Everybody wanted to start the Uber of X. And they said, I am a platform owner. I will run this website and brand. Somebody else is doing the heavy lifting. Here we were saying that we want to set up a factory. Very contrarian, but we believed that we were on the right path. We just knew that we wanted to meet the price point. To do that, you need to manufacture. That means you have to get your hands dirty, sit in a factory, so be it. It's very simple logic, not that we had any grand ambition. So that is how we solved the price angle. So convenience angle, we solved by delivering to their homes where they didn't have to step out of the home at all. The third thing that I talked about was testing and trying and buying.
Yeah,
that's very important. The prevailing wisdom was that it's a product category that is only touch and feel. You cannot buy without touching and feeling. So when we read the science of sleep, we and every research everywhere in the world, the most important thing that came out was that actually it is not a touch and feel product at all. The reason being, you as a person will know whether you like it or not only after sleeping on that mattress for 14-15 days at a stretch. So you telling yourself a story that I slept on it for 5 minutes in a store, this felt better than that, and hence I'm buying this, is actually a story you're telling yourself. So what we did was concentrate all our marketing on educating consumers that that's the wrong way to buy. And how do we still overcome the burden? We gave a 30-day trial. We said, you buy, retain it in your privacy of your home. And in 30 days, if you don't like it, if it doesn't suit you, we will take it back and refund the money. And this 30 days we extended to 100 days later on, industry leading. And it's still to this day, it is a 100-day trial period for our mattress segment.
So people actually try and return mattresses? And is
correct.
That...
correct. So they buy from us. They try it in the privacy of their home. They, their partner, their spouse, whoever it might be. They like it. They keep it. They don't like it. They return it. And we refund the full money. There's no terms and conditions. No hidden star somewhere niche. It's very simple, direct. And say, we honor that promise. So trust us.
And you mentioned a bit about how when you're trying to fundraise, you know, VCs understood consumer tech, but not really D2C and building a consumer brand. So can you tell us what some of the key differences are?
Sure. In consumer tech, you usually focus on being asset light. You try and create value through software. You try and create value through a product, software product. And drive very non-linear value to the platform by bringing together different parts of the value chain. So Uber brought together supply and demand. Amazon brought together sellers and buyers. So people like that, they created this tremendous value with a software product, which was completely driven with engineers and product managers. And you didn't need much else. And that itself was becoming tremendously valuable. So the in that industry, what happens is, the gestation period for a VC to get his return back is 3 to 5 years or 5 to 6 years. It's very, very fast. The valuation going up or going down is very, very fast. So, and valuation quantum going up or down is also very, very fast. It can go 10x. So you recently would have seen Cred has gone from 800 million to 2.2 billion valuation within 7 months. You will see a lot more other software product companies going up in valuation, fintech, where they're driving lot more transactions. The valuations of grow up stocks is all going up very, very rapidly. So they're creating tremendous value through that platform, and that's why investors are betting on that. The third thing is that the ability to build a nonlinear scale is extremely high there, which means you either have huge, tremendous returns or the company will go bust.
Mm.
Those are the, it's a winner-take-all kind of a market because network effects play a very strong role. Come to consumer brands, you need to invest and backward integrate, which is a much slower process.
Okay.
There is usually room for 2, 3, 4, 5 companies in a particular sector. So there is no winner-take-all economics. Third, the valuation will go up in a more linear pace. It is not going to go up from 50 million today to 500 million 6 months later to 1 billion 9 months later. It is going to have a much more linear curve. And fourth thing is that this is not a sector where you either go big or go bust. You can still build a very valuable firm by just working hard and steadily adding value and earning customer trust. So this differentiation and understanding that consumer tech and consumer brands are very different was absent in the VC ecosystem back then when we were starting up, when we were raising.
Yeah, that's really interesting. So it sounds like very different macro conditions for both. But wanted to talk a bit more about Wakefit and understand how did Wakefit evolve from what you described, you know, mattress company into a complete home solution provider?
We, as the company started doing well, our ambitions also started getting bigger. And one thing that had always helped us was to listen to consumers. So we had only mattresses. And consumers started asking, I want to buy pillow also. Would you recommend a site? I want to buy bed sheets. Would you recommend, which place do I go and buy? Why aren't you guys selling it? So we started launching pillows, bed sheets, comforters, dohars. Started doing all of that steadily one after the other. And slowly it became that we had sleep and sleep accessories. So we started positioning a lot of our content around sleep. And post that, we realized people started asking us, hey, I bought a bed frame from this store, online or offline. This is the URL. What size mattress should I buy? And then why are you guys not selling the same thing with us? So we said, okay, consumers are asking this also, so let us get into bed frames. Let's not get into the whole furniture range. We have no knowledge or capability. Let's do beds. So we understood bed manufacturing. We got into understanding how hardwood is sourced, shisham wood. How is it treated? How is it manufactured? How is it broken down? How is it polished? and we learned the whole thing, set up factories, and went through the whole journey all over again for the next 9-10 months. Once we learned that, people started asking, where is the bedside table? People started asking, it's the same material, where is the coffee table? So we said, okay, we know that the factories are the same, machinery is the same, labor is the same, skills are the same, and customers are asking for it. So why not expand now? So the plan was to expand slowly, but then the pandemic happened. And we were forced to sit on our hands for 45 days, March 22nd to May 4th last year. So it became a blessing in disguise where we completed the R&D prototyping and identification of factory and factory land for furniture in those 45 days, because we had nothing else to do on the core business. So that's how, once the lockdown was lifted in May, we launched the whole furniture range at one go in June and July. So it was a very organic thing where our ambitions also grew and customers also trusted us, and it worked out.
It seems like it's been a pattern from the start for you guys. You know, you customers told you your pain points, and then they helped you continue grow and evolve.
You're very right.
I also want to talk a bit about marketing online and acquiring users, especially in a D2C context, because of course it's quite different. And we'll also specifically love it if you could tell us the story about the viral Wake Fit sleep internship campaign that you guys did. And you know, what about that? So I'd love to hear a bit more about how you came up with that idea.
Sure. So I always like to talk about how D2C is slightly different from just building a consumer brand. So D2C in my mind is much more than just saying it's a channel of sales. D2C is a way of life, which means your consumers have direct access to you, whether they're buying it through your own website, through a marketplace, through a retailer in a store, through Nilgiris or Reliance Hypermart, wherever you manage to get distribution, that does not matter. That's not what D2C I'm talking about. The D2C I'm talking about is, because you're a brand and because you've cut through all these middlemen and you're directly in some way reaching out to consumers, they have the ability to tell you what they like and don't like that they never had earlier with a traditional brand. Because in a traditional sense, they would never interact with the brand at all. So they would just buy from a retailer, who would have bought it from a distributor, who would have bought it from a super stockist, who would have finally dealt with the brand. And the brand would do a consumer survey once in 2 years. They'll commission a Nielsen or a Kantar or IMRB and say, do this 1,000 consumer study and give me the insights and so on and so forth. But D2C, we are talking to consumers every single day, every single day. Whether they like us, they don't like us, a product is for something they love, stitches came out, or their daughter is sleeping very well, or the furniture helped their aged parent, or some product was delayed, every single thing is out there in the public. So that's a blessing and a huge responsibility. It's a blessing because that valuable feedback is what enables us to be ahead of the curve in product development and iteration and making it better. And it's a responsibility because you cannot screw up at all, because customers come back and they're very vocal about it. They put their faith in you. They put their money in you, hard-earned money. And now we let go of that faith. So we have to earn that trust back. We have to go solve that problem for them and get that trust back. So that's how the D2C model is slightly different in my mind, that you're constantly listening to consumers. And sleep internship was also from that itself. We realized that the narrative back then when we started sleep internship was that, oh, our Prime Minister Modi is sleeping only 4 or 5 hours. Oh, look at any tycoon, business tycoon who built a multi-billion dollar business. They're just sleeping for 4 hours, the remaining 18 hours or 20 hours. They're just working. The way to success is to lose sleep and just constantly obsess about a product. So we said, what if we don't have the marketing dollars to do a television campaign? We don't have the marketing dollars to go on radio or Times of India or anything. So what if we turned this whole narrative on its head and said, we will bloody celebrate people who value their sleep. So what best way to celebrate rather than pay them for it? Saying that, you boss, you go sleep, I will pay you for it. So this came from a mad brainstorming session internally with our creative agency. So we said, let's choose these really massive icons, LeBron James, Roger Federer, Oprah Winfrey, people who value their sleep and still been extremely successful in what they do in life.
Focus on.
Yeah.
Good example.
Because sleep is not just rest. Your mind and body does 100 things when you're asleep that enables you to function when you're awake. So we said, let's celebrate it and let's pay 1 lakh. And we said the internship period will be 100 days because that again reinforces our 100-day trial as a subliminal message. So that was a genesis. We created a film. You won't believe how little it cost us to create the film and sort of put it out there. But it gave us nearly 100 plus stories, took us on to about 10 or 15 radio stations across the country, 2 television stations, and it gave us a lot of earned media and a lot of recognition and love from customers. It was brilliant. So then we did our season 2. This first season 1, we received 1.65 lakh applications. Now, this year, season 2, we received 5 lakh applications.
Nice. So the winner gets the money and like everybody competes. And that's...
No, no. Last year we chose 23 interns and every one of them got 1 lakh each.
Ah, okay. So all of them. Okay.
So it's So you had to prove that you loved sleep and you had to go through 2 rounds and your final round was a celebrity interview with Cyrus Brocha, Mallika Dua and all that. And once you were selected, you were in. You got that 1 lakh stipend and you had to sleep and... You have to make video logs. You have to basically, we were using those 23 people to prove to the rest of the world that your life gets better when you sleep well. That's all.
That's incredible. Really smart way to do it. Love how you guys came up with it. And so you spoke a bit about COVID and how you actually use that downtime to, you know, come up with your new furniture product lines. But how has COVID impacted your business? Are people buying furniture and beds, mattresses during the pandemic?
Yes. Worldwide, this whole sector has grown. And the hypothesis for us is that suddenly the home is not just the place you come after work and sleep at night. The home has become 2 people's workspace, 1 or 2 children's school, your entertainment room at night, your parents' relaxing room. Mm-hmm. So the home has become very versatile. And suddenly you realize that it's not equipped to service all of these people at the same time in one place.
Right.
So they started investing. They started investing in a better couch, better TV unit, better dining table. People were sitting on the gadda and eating. Now they have a dining table. Right. They were just working on the gadda. They now have a study table, study chair. They've just set up the remaining parts of their home, invested, because now that became a large part of their day.
Yeah. That
Worldwide, sense. That's been the phenomenon. And online also has picked up because offline, nobody would want to go to a store, risk their this thing and so forth. So that's how it's happened.
And what's next for WakeFit? What can we look forward to? I mean, you guys have come a long way in a short time.
Exciting. Yeah, I think we crossed about 400 crore revenue in FY21. We're very, very happy that over 1 lakh customer reviews were across the internet, in all the platforms put together. They trust us, word of mouth is good. So I think the beauty of what we do is that we don't know where we are going next. We will be humble enough to be led by consumers. If they want us to launch new adjacent products, if they want us to launch new services, slowly we will create those products and services and launch it. But the clear path now is that in the home sector, we have a lot more things to do. In the home sector and servicing the rest of India, we have a lot more things to do. So I think that's what we're going to put our heads down and continue to do for the next 12 months, while we also listen to consumers and see what they want us to do next.
No, that's amazing. And Chaitanya, you seem like a very calm person. Does having a WakeFit mattress help with that? How do you manage stress, especially at these times?
I know a lot of founders and being an entrepreneur can be an extremely stressful roller coaster journey. You have highs that you've never seen before and you'll see lows that you've never seen before. And the idea is, how do you detach yourself from that and find equilibrium through what is there inside you rather than what signals you're receiving from outside? And having lost 2 startups, literally lived on 3,000 rupees a week, then going back to a job. Now that a company is working, I'm just grateful that we've built a company that employs 2,000 plus people, and we are able to serve lakhs and lakhs of customers every month. It's just extremely grateful. That's the strongest feeling that we have. And on top of it, now that we have built a very core senior team with us who have believed in the Wakefit vision and joined us in the last 2 years, that the load of building a company is also shared with the senior leadership. And people who have joined us in 2016, 2017, they're still with us. They've gotten married, they've taken a two-wheeler loan, they've taken a car loan, they've bought vehicles, they've set up a home loan. So that is, I can't tell you how happy it makes me feel. And that is, those are the things that you look at that are always steady and give you that confidence, rather than what went right or wrong with the business today, rather than what ups or downs that the external environment is going to throw at you today. These are good things. These are steady things. These are things that worst case, if the company does not do well and we have to shutter it tomorrow morning, would I be regretting this experience? Not a minute. We have just taken salary, not any exits and so forth. So would I regret it? Never. I think what it has transformed me in these 5 years, what I've been able to build, it's just so humbling. And to come back to your question about how I've seen other founder friends deal with it, some people build a very close-knit founder support group. They share, they go for a beer, they chill, they share their problems, they pick up the phone and talk. Some other people end up having mentors and coaches. So they work with somebody who's an experienced entrepreneur or a professional executive coach. And the third category is mine, which is there are people like me who like to process things. So a lot of my lessons, learning all happens from internalizing things, analyzing things, writing it down in old fashioned pen and paper, reading books, listening to podcasts, just processing and let all of that assimilate into a new lesson, a new path forward. So there are people who share, there are people who have coaches or guides, and then there are people who internalize and assimilate everything. I probably fall in the third category.
Understand. No, thank you for sharing that way. Wonderful learning from you. I think what really brings both Mazen and I a lot of joy when we have these conversations is we end up learning a lot. Like every conversation, I'm just listening to founders like you share your stories, and it's wonderful seeing how you guys have evolved, your journeys and the key learnings. I think fascinating, and I think that sense of gratitude and gratefulness it's awesome. It's something that will stay with me after this conversation as well. So our final question that we ask all our guests is, what's one piece of unfiltered feedback or advice that you've received in your career which really changed the way you think? Is the reason why we call this Founders Unfiltered. If you could share that.
Somebody I respect tremendously, she told me that, she's an external person, somebody I respect, but she told me that one of the patterns she's noticed with me is that things become really, really crazy and stressful at work. And when I'm extremely inundated with a lot of external pressures, I withdraw into myself to go solve that problem. She said, that's a great thing. That is what has helped you become a good founder. But the thing that is causing the flip side of this is, in such situations is actually where you need to be a visible leader. Which means if you are feeling this stress, if you are feeling that there are so many things that are overwhelming, you imagine what your team will be feeling. I know you will be absorbing a lot of it and you're not passing everything on, but they will also be feeling, because they're part of that external environment. So despite that not being your natural behavior, you should put in that effort to be the visible leader, talk to people, write to people, chat with people, take them out for lunch. So it doesn't have to be sitting and giving a speech. Visible leadership is a lot of other small things. So I know you are trying to do it because it's for the best of the company, but it has these other impacts that you are not noticing at all. So that was a big eye-opener for me. So now when my natural tendency is to go solve that problem with a lot of focus, I still do that, because that is who I am. But I also earmark time to balance it off to spend time with the team because they are part of the solution. I need to take them along with me. So I think that was a really eye-opening feedback.
Amazing. Yeah, that will stay with me as well. Fantastic. I think a lot of us tend to, at least in India, tend to have that instinctive thought process of not really sharing what we are feeling. We keep it in ourselves. And you put it really well when you said that, you know, as a leader, the solution is taking people along as well. It's fascinating, and thank you for sharing. Thanks a lot, Chaitanya, for doing this. I really enjoyed the conversation. I'm sure our listeners will. Congrats once again on what you've built, and wishing a lot of success for Wakefield.
Thank you, Avidin. Part of the joy of why we come on podcasts is because we derive so many learnings by listening to podcasts. So if our experiences can give somebody else an inspirational thought or some idea that was stewing in their mind, I think that's the true value of why it's worth spending this time on this. So thank you.